Thank you. Hey, good morning. Glad you're here. We're thankful to God that you're here today. I know it's raining outside, but it sure is good in here. And all the church said, amen. Hey, today I want to introduce to you the Porter family. They're sitting over to my left. I'm going to ask them if they would stand. She's got bambinos and babies everywhere. This is Christopher, Heather, Connor, Avery, and Mary. And we've been able to meet with them. Both of them are saved, giving their life to Christ, and they want to become a part a First Family here at CenterStar. So I want to ask you to do me a big favor. Welcome them to the family of God. And we're so glad to have you guys. And you have two daughters. So it's three girls. So pray for him heavily. He's outnumbered a lot. Amen. So it's so good to have them this morning. Hey, we're glad you're here today. We got some a great service playing, a phenomenal message. In just a minute, I'll be introducing our special speaker. We're glad you're here today. Let's all stand as we begin to worship this morning.
It's good to see everybody here. Hope everybody's had a great week. Let's join together and sing Love Lifted Me.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from a peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, master of the sea, billows his will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me.
Give the Lord a good hand. Amen. God bless you. Be seated. Thank you all so much for welcoming the Porter family. And after the service, just tell them thank you and praying for you and ask the Lord to bless them. Hey, just two or three real quick things. Many of you know we celebrated last week one more time paying the building off. And everybody said, give God thanks. Amen. And soon as we know kind of when we'll celebrate that, we'll give you that information just a little bit. Later on. Hey, I've asked a couple of people in church to do something. This is kind of different and a little bit weird maybe, but Tracy Smith. How many of y'all know Tracy, little blonde lady? Well, you may not know it. She has a gun. It's a 489 Magnum something. And she's on security. She helps train, I think, some of the police department. I don't know. She's on the shooting range is all I know, and I'm scared of her. Her husband said that if she shoots at you, lay down. You're dead. You just don't know it. But I've asked her to do something. That is, we're going to do an awareness class here just to help people be aware of things that's going on. And so when you go into a parking lot, especially, Mom, if I had a young daughter, I would want you to be a part of this class. Brother Brad, would you raise your hand? Brad, Captain, I think I said Lieutenant Captain of the Florence Police Department. He's going to be there to answer questions. Here's why we're doing that. In our society today, we just have so much going on. We really just need to be aware of the situations we may find ourselves in. What can we do to be proactive, especially with moms and daughters? Now, I don't want to say a lot there other than you need to be as prepared as you absolutely can. Amen? So on Wednesday night, on February 21st, we're going to do that. So I hope you will join us, moms and dads. Hey, also, Christian, where you at, Brother Christian? Just come up. We're going to have a Valentine's banquet. We're going to have the newlywed game, so I can't be a part of it. Because I've been married about 100 years, so brother. But go have a lot of fun that night. So you need to sign up for that. That just kind of came up. Looks like a lot of fun. Good food, anytime food, it's good. So we're going to be there to be a part of that. Hey, This morning, my dear friend Tim Anderson is here. Brother Tim, we're so thankful to have you here. Tim and Miss Sherry is sick on him, couldn't make it today. Has three children, six grandkids, long time pastor of Clements, and got to see what the miracle literally that took place on 72, how God started that whole ministry. And you may know Tim by hearing him on the radio. He's just retired from that, doing something else called ICR. There's cards out there. He's going to explain that to you. I'm not going to say a lot about that other than to say this. Tim has had a tremendous influence on our area locally. God has used him, his voice, his ministry to touch hearts and lives in a phenomenal, supernatural way. But also, he has a ministry that's international, and God's going to show you some of that today. And I want you to hear that. So if there's something there, maybe God warms your heart up about, you feel passionate about, he's going to share that. He has a tremendous word, but I want you to hear about ICR and what God's doing. Hey, listen carefully. God's just not moving in Alabama. God's moving all over the world. And I want you to hear that personally from people like Tim, who's out there in different parts of the world, and you'll hear about that in a moment to do that. So you're going to get to hear my dear friend, blessed brother, great pastor, just so many things we could say about him. Tim, we're just so honored that you're here. How don't you do me a favor? Would you go ahead and welcome him here this morning? We're glad to have Tim Anderson. Tim, we prayerfully look forward to hearing from you today, okay? Hey, I'm fixing to pray, and after that, I want to ask you to do me a favor. Hey, Tim, Lisa and Tony Best have made it home. Tony has a lot of situations, y'all know that, so please pray for them this morning and ask God to bless. Hey, you're here today and maybe something's going on privately in your life. You just want to say, hey, Pastor, please pray for me. Wow, hands all over the place. Well, let's pray. Father, we love you, and we just thank you for what you're going to birth in our hearts in a minute when we hear this word. But God, hear about ICR and what you're doing in so many places around the world. And so, God, we just ask you today to minister through the word, through hearing about what you're doing. And God, we pray for the hands that were raised. There's always needs in a crowd this large that, Father, you'd bless them. So, Father, we pray through the worship, through the music, through the message you'd minister to them. Father, we love you and thank you now for what you have done. But we bless you for what you're going to do in Jesus' name. And all the church said, amen. Hey, stand for me if you don't mind. Do me a favor. Find two or three people right there next to you. You don't have to go too far. Shake hands, hug a couple of necks. Welcome each other to the church.
None of them pick it up. They didn't pick it up either. It was gone. I thought it was. No, the mic. What is it?
Give me this freedom. Tell me who can give me this far.
give me this freedom? Tell me who could get me this far? Ain't nobody love me like Jesus. I know, nobody could. Destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, suffered as he. in power forever. Awesome and great is your name. You are the
so much for this day that you've given us and another opportunity to be able to come to your house and worship you and praise your holy name. And God, we're just so humbled by who you are and how amazing and awesome that you are. And we thank you for being such a great God. And thank you for coming to this earth to die on the cross for us so we can have that relationship with you and you can be our Savior. Because without you, we wouldn't have any hope. And God, we just love you so much. And I just pray that you just be with Brother Tim this morning as he brings your word and presents the message that you have planned for us. And I pray that you give him the speaking grace and the words and the ability to recall everything he's prepared for this morning. I pray that you just help him with all of that. And I just thank you so much for Jesus dying on the cross. Please forgive my sins. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much for the worship. Could we thank this team again for the great job they have done? It's twice I've got to hear them and be encouraged by them this morning. And hey, our brother's got a big water jug there, don't he? Yeah, so he's the man and I'm the sissy, I guess. That's all I know. But I noticed I leaned over to Heath. I said, don't mess with his water jug. So he's not. So thank you, Brother Ronnie. Miss Judy, so good to see you. Love your pastor and pastor's wife. We've been friends for a long time. As Junior Hill would say, I've been listening to Brother Ronnie preach for about 100 years now, right? So I'm grateful to be here. Thank you for the opportunity. For almost 30 years, just served right up the highway east of here, as you know, at Clements. So the Lord blessed our ministry there, and I'm grateful for the opportunity that we had to serve. But as I left the church, I told them, I'm leaving what I love to pursue what I love. So part of my ministry these last dozen or so years has been in the areas of pastoral training for our pastors in different countries and even locally as well. So we are involved in that very deeply now, and the Lord has blessed us and given us a good start. And I'm just trying to stay out of the way and not mess it up and keep going the right direction. Brother Kip, let me thank you. I jokingly said to Brother Kip in between the services, if I didn't know any better, I'd think you were a pastor. As kind as he has been to me this week, because Brother Ronnie sure ain't going to be nice to me, so somebody has to, right? So, Brother Kip, thank you. And I want to publicly thank you for checking, calling, and making sure everything was in. And so I appreciate so much your the details. It's in Solomon, the second chapter. But there's a little verse in there that it's about marriage, but it applies to many different areas. But it says in there, it's the small foxes that spoil the vine. Well, it's the details that make anything, whether it's a church, whether it's a corporation, your personal life, my personal life. It's the small things, the details, being disciplined enough to see things out. So self-discipline is a very big thing. So when a church is paying attention to the details, the way that this church has done and continues to do, then you know you're going into a good place. So I'm grateful for that. And then, of course, it's good to see several of our folks from Clements here this morning, David, Emily, Scott. So good to see you guys, Jade and Destiny. I'm grateful to see you guys as well. You really make Scott look good in public, sitting by him there. Yeah, you really do. So, Scott, you did well this morning. I'm telling you, you did well. I don't know that I see any more Clements folks around, but if you are, then it's your fault. You knew what you was getting when you came here, so you shouldn't have came, is all I can tell you. But thank you for allowing me to be here. And then let me quickly say, from a pastor's perspective, congratulations on paying your building off. Can we thank the Lord again for that, for y'all? I promise you, I don't get to say that very often or thank congregations for that or brag on you for that. But that just means you can give more to ICR now. That's what that means, right? So seriously, we do take serious our role in bringing our pastors in. Brother Ronnie's asked me to say a little bit about that, and I want to. And I've got a video. It's about a 3.5-minute long video that I'll play for you in just a second. But long story short, ICR, International Congress on Revival, is a ministry to pastors and their wives, staff members, key lay people, people who help the pastor do things that he does throughout the week that only heaven knows about. ICR was started by a Southern Baptist evangelist by the name of Manly Beasley. Manley's in heaven now. He passed his ministry off to Bill Stafford, who also is in heaven now. I thought twice about taking it after that. You know what I'm saying? I can see where this ministry is leading to the grave. But Brother Bill trained me, was literally, and I say it with all sincerity and humility, was my father in the faith. Sherry and I loved him so much. Miss Sue still living there in one of the assisted living homes in Chattanooga. She's doing well. She's 94 now, I believe. And if you don't want to know what she feels like, don't ask her, because she will. She's 94. She can tell you that, right? And it's okay. But pray for them. Then I ask you, totally unrelated to me being here today, but my heart is grieving. At the same time, celebrating the homegoing of someone that Sherry and I love dearly. One of my dearest friends, Mickey Wolf, who is the golf pro at Canebrake in Athens, his wife, Stacy, has been in a four-year journey with cancer, and she lost that battle last night. So talking to Mickey last night and this morning, arrangements are being made, but many of you may, of course, she's lived that battle out publicly on social media for these years. And so pray for the Wolf family, for Mickey, for their children. They're really hurting, as you can imagine, and struggling. So I ask you to pray for them. But that's what we do, is basically bring a pastor in, encourage them. I see our supplements, the places, the meals, the conference material, everything. So this video will give you just a little sample of places that we have been. We continue to go. Mexico is in here, which is a new place for us that we leave to go in April. I leave Wednesday of this, or Thursday of this week, for Canada. You'll see a little bit of that in here. So guys, if you would play that, and I'll come back and wrap that part up.
Conference, I learn a lot. I'm learning to be a peacemaker as a leader. I'm learning to be an encourager.
Estamos muy agradecidos también por la posibilidad de participar de un seminario así, con altos costos para nuestra nación, pero muy agradecidos también por el envío de recursos para que a nosotros se nos suavice un poco la posibilidad de poder asistir. Así que les agradecemos mucho a aquellos que invierten su dinero, su tiempo y su energía y sus dones también para poder ministrarnos y poder crecer en la obra del Señor.
challenged me in so many different ways that examining my heart and giving me a deeper understanding of God's word and the meaning of it.
Sampling of some of the places that we have been and continue to go to. Also out on the foyer, out at the table there, connection card or your connection area, there'll be a little prayer card with mine and Sherry's picture and name on it, some information. I share that with you to ask you to pray for us. As I said, we leave on Thursday of this week to go to Canada. You saw part of that in there. It's a big opportunity. There's about 14 different countries, Brother Ronnie, that's represented in Canada. So melting pot of diversity, as we say, and a lot of ministers, a lot of pastors, and a lot of hurt come into that conference. So I ask you to pray for us as we travel there. If you would, find two passages of Scripture. The book of Genesis, find chapter 12, and then we're going to work our way through a few verses and upcoming chapters there. And then when you find Genesis, turn over to the book of 2 Peter. 2 Peter in the New Testament. If you go to 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, you went just a tad too far. So back up just a little bit. And I'm going to read, I'm going to leave the passages in Genesis for us to work through exegetically as we get into that. But then I'm going to read for our time together. And I'm going to ask you, if you would, to stand in honor of the Lord and His Word. And follow along with me as I read. In 2 Peter chapter 2, I'll begin reading in verse 4. For if God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment. Now, observation there. If God will judge an angel, He'll judge me and you. If judgment can be given out for angels who are procreated, then rest assured, there'll be judgment for me and you to deal with. You'll either stand before the Lord at the great white throne judgment, which is what you don't want to do, it's found in Revelation chapter 20, or what you will want to do is be before Him in the Bema seat in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 and following. But either way, saved or lost, we all will stand before the Lord. And this section of Scripture right here is letting us know how serious of a situation that happens to be. So the Bible goes on to say, and He did not spare the ancient world. So if He didn't, and He didn't, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly, turning the cities of Sodom and America. Well, it says Gomorrah, but rest assured, none of us, I don't think, would disagree that America could be put there. That's where we are in our country. Sins that are unspeakable, things we never would have thought or believed would be happening right before our face. Things that we're entertained by today that we never thought would have happened. Sodom and Gomorrah, into ashes, condemning them to destruction, making them an example. So we look at the ancient world and see it as an example of what will happen to us if we continue on this slide. To those who afterward, that would be us, would live ungodly. And He delivered, and here's the message, pay attention to this part, and delivered righteous Lot. Now just a little caveat. If it were not for Genesis 12 and following, and 2 Peter 2, the section we just read, we would never have enough ammunition, enough knowledge, enough wisdom to figure out that Lot was a believer. We would never know that he was going to heaven when he died because he lived such a hellacious life. He literally was a man who was a believer, but he lived a life of hell on the earth. We can learn a lot from Lot. We can learn a lot from his life. We can learn a lot from the things he did and mostly the things he didn't do. Who delivered righteous Lot, who was oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelling among them tormented his righteous soul from day to day by seeing and hearing their lawless deeds. Now, verse 9, I'm not going to preach, but I want to read because it's just a good verse. Then the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations. Could I get a witness? Anybody ever been delivered? Anybody ever been on the brink of collapse, the brink of failure, the brink of disaster, just the brink of going under, and just in the moment, in the nick of time, God rescued you? Anybody say amen to that? As you look back upon the past, are you grateful for what he did in your life? He knows how to rescue all of us that want to be rescued. But here's the caveat. Many don't want to be. Many do not want to be. Too many people want to know behind what's behind door number 3. We got too many people wanting to know stuff like that. When you know up front it's not going to be good, it's not going to be good for you, your family, or your community, but yet we continue to go down that road anyway. The Lord knows how to deliver the godly from the temptations that we face and to reserve the unjust under punishment for their day and the day of judgment. Father, use me to make you smile. Use me in a way that would cause you to say, you did good, son. But then most of all, Father, I pray that you would draw the lost to you today. I do believe predominantly I speak to Christian people today. I do believe that. But at the same time, I'm sure I speak to people who are trapped, who are living a hell on the earth. The smiles look good. Everything about them look good. But there are just some things that need to be fixed on the inside. So I pray that the Holy Spirit would do the work that only He can do in this room today. And I'll be careful to give you the praise for all in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You can be seated and thank you. Again, as I said, we can learn a lot from Lot. We can learn a lot from his life. Though he had everything going for him spiritually, he was 1,000 miles away from where God wanted him to be. He had the right uncle. That was Abraham. We'll see that in just a moment. He was brought up in a good family, even though his family did not worship the Lord. He was saved out of a very pagan, ritualistic environment. But Lot sold out to the world, here we go, of materialism. And I just want to say up front something I've learned. And I bet you have too, and I bet you know it. The only cure for materialism is generosity. The only thing that's going to fix this pull toward the climate that we have, the community that we live in, the materialistic age in which we live. The only thing that will fix that is to be a man or a woman or a church or a person that gives. You have to give your way beyond that. And I also am aware of the fact that this sermon is contradictory to a certain degree. Christians don't go to hell. But Christians on their way to heaven can live and look like they're on their way to hell. Now, that sounds almost hypocritical as well. It sounds almost heretical. But at the same time, you read the Bible, you read the situation, and you read the words that we'll see in a moment, and it's very clear that Lot was a believer, but he was a believer that the enemy was controlling. And I fear that some I even speak to today could be flirting with or living in a situation that certainly God wants to deliver the godly, verse 9, out of the situation that we're in. If you'll look back at this text that we just read, look at verse 7, 8, and the B part of verse 8. We read 3 times. Let's prove our case here about Lot. He's called just Lot. It's the word dikaios in the Greek language. He's just Lot. If you look at verse 8, he's the righteous Lot, the righteous man, the same word. If you look at the B part, calls him his righteous soul. Lot lived a hell upon the earth. He was a believer, had asked Yahweh, as we sang about a moment ago, to deliver him, to save him, to come into his life. He did that. But yet at the same time, he was being controlled by a culture, a community that was leading him down the wrong situation. He allowed his family to be devoured as a result of his weak commitment. Now, question. We've read this section of Scripture, and we see that there's only two spots here that talk about Lot's life positively, the book of Genesis, and of course we've read here in 2 Peter. Let me ask a question. Just I thought about this week. I never had Brother Ronnie thought about it this way. How many of you, and I bet it's a bunch of you, could tell me right now what the shortest verse of the Bible is? It's two words. Now, this is an open book test. And if y'all don't know, I'll just have to keep preaching. So help me out. If I got to preach and amen too, we'll never get out of here. All right, so what's the shortest verse of the Bible? Jesus wept. Where's it found? See, he's got Google. He's got Google. Anybody know the second shortest verse in the Bible? Now, don't use Google for that one. Anybody know the second shortest verse? Turn, if you would, to Luke. Luke chapter 17, verse 32. It's three words. Remember Lot's wife. That's ironic, isn't it? Jesus wept, the shortest. And then the second shortest, three words, remember Lot's wife. Now, if I'm Eve, I'm ticked. What's Lot's wife's name? We don't even know her name. We're never told her name. But if I'm Eve, I'm thinking, why didn't you say remember me? I was the first woman. You had to put the man to sleep to bring me into this stuff. What about Deborah? If I'm Deborah, I'm upset. The first prophet. What about Esther? She keeps Israel from going into a genocide. I mean, seriously, out of the 170-something women that are mentioned in the Bible, we're told by the Lord to remember Lot's wife, but we don't even know her name, but yet we must know something about her life. She was the victim of a husband that sold out to the culture. She was a victim of a husband that sold out to everything that didn't matter, and yet the children that were birthed from his wife that we're told to remember had to endure the situations that he led them through as well. So let's walk through Lot's life. We have to go back to the book of Genesis for that. But go back to the first book of your Bible and let's walk through Lot's life. First of all, he had deliverance. Lot was delivered. He was saved. Look at chapter 12, verse 4. And here's what I want you to notice, this little phrase. So Abram went as the Lord had told him to go, and Lot went with him. Now, underline that little phrase, because that little phrase is mentioned four or five different times from chapters 12 all the way through chapter 19. We won't read them all, but a couple of them we will refer to because it's very important to know that where Abraham went, Lot went. It's important to know that Lot was running with a good man. Even though we know Abraham was not a perfect guy, no more than any of us were, but he was still the father of our faith. He was who God chose to change the Hebrew nation in chapter 12, moving into chapter 13. So it's a pretty massive storyline here that Lot went with him, which means that we have to believe, first of all, that Lot endured or Lot enjoyed a special family and a special kind of family. We all know the story of Abraham. Abraham was called by God out of the land of Ur, of the Chaldees. He was his daddy, Terah, was a moon worshiper, which means that you can be brought up in an ungodly home and still turn out okay. We have so many days saying, well, I was raised this way, or my daddy was this, my daddy was that. I understand all that, but you still make your own decisions. I still make my own decisions. All of us still make our own decisions. So Lot was afforded, if you would, a very special family. Abraham's faith caused him to linger before an altar. Abraham's faith caused him to live in a tent and move from tent to tent, from Bedouin camp to Bedouin camp. And at the same time, it caused him also to look for a city whose builder and maker was not made with hands. So Lot grew up with some good preaching. Lot grew up as a good ministry's family, if you would. And the decision that Abraham made affected his family, and the decision that Abraham made obviously affected his nephew, Lot. Lot was born in the Ur of the Chaldees as well, just as his uncle was. Lot's father, Haran, died very suddenly, so he was taken into the family. We see that as well. And here's what I want to say before I even move forward, because it's still true today, all these years later. Every family decision affects kids and grandkids in some way, shape, or another. Every decision I make affects my kids. Every decision I make, or Sherry and I make, affects our grandkids, affects our community, affects your family. Those type decisions are not made on isolated islands. They affect so many people. But yet at the same time, we see that he was born in a very special family. Secondly, it's obvious that he enjoyed a saving faith. You cannot read the text and not believe that there are much evidence here of his salvation. Look at chapter 13 and look at verse 1 with me. We have a special family. He has a saving faith, verse 1, chapter 13. So Abram went up from Egypt. There was a famine, remember? And he and his wife and all that he had, and notice this phrase again, here it is, twice, and Lot with him. The same faith that Abraham showed, it's obvious Lot showed. Lot was probably one of Abraham's tent revivals. Most likely, Lot was listening to him on the side of the mountain. And I'm just telling you my spiritual imagination here. We're not told it's true. We're not told it's not true. So it's my sermon. I'm going to preach it the way I want to. Y'all good with that? I believe that Abraham was out there preaching, and old Lot was tied up, listening behind his camel. He was listening to Yahweh being preached. He was listening to the Word of God being preached. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit grips his heart. He realizes that I will go with you, Yahweh, and I will want to be born again and saved today. And he did. He gave his hand and his heart to his uncle, but he gave his life also to the Lord Jesus as well. So he has a saving faith. He has a very special, special family. And I don't know exactly how it happened, but he had his time and he had his place, which leads me to ask you this question. Do you have your time? Do you have your place? And once you go to your time and your place in your mind, we'll ask you this. Will those living around you and in the same house you are living in know that you've had your time and place? Because Lot didn't live that way. Lot had his time. Lot had his place. It was somewhere on the plains of Jordan, somewhere where Abraham was preaching. But yet no one around him knew that God was a part of his life. He was a horrible representation of what the Lord wants us all to model. So a special family, a saving faith, and it's obviously also very clear here that Abraham and Lot both had significant fortunes. In other words, they were not poor. They were people of means. And the text tells us that as well. Look at chapter 13, verse 5. Lot went with Abram. There it is again. That's the third time you've read that. Lot went with Abram, which had flocks and herds. In other words, his material, his wealth, his goods was made up in the flocks and the herds that he had. God blessed Abraham with material prosperity. God blessed Lot with material prosperity. But Lot forgot what Moses said. In Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18, Moses said that it is God who gives us power to make wealth. Somewhere along the line, Lot must have thought he was doing it. Somewhere along the line, Abraham might have even thought he was doing it. Somewhere along the line, there could be somebody sitting in this room this day thinking that you are responsible for the house you live in. Someone in this room today thinking you're responsible for the car you drive, the clothes you wear. But you're not. It is God who gets you up every morning. It is God who puts breath in your lungs. It is God who gave you the job that you have. It is God who gave you the home you live in. It is God who gives you the car that you drive. It is God who gives you everything you have. You don't give to God anything that He hadn't first given to you. We have forgotten where our blessings come from. We've forgotten who it is that hewed us out of the rock, put our feet on a solid rock, establish our goings, and put a new song in our heart, as the Bible says in Psalm 42. So we have a special family, a saving faith, and a significant, significant fortune. Now, it's tragic, isn't it, when God's people cannot get along? It's tragic when churches can't get along. It's tragic, not that it happens in your church, but I'm sure it happens at Clements, right? Where I used to pastor. I'll leave you all out of it, put it in Clements. There's folks that probably won't speak to folks on one side of the building or the other. There's folks that maybe come to the first service of this church because they don't want to come to the second service because you're in it. And you came to this one because you didn't want to come to the first one because they're in it. And both of you are wrong. It's very unfortunate, very ungodly, and very damning when God's people cannot get along. Romans chapter 2, verse 24 says it this way: the name of God has been and continues to be blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you, because of me. The name of God is blasphemed. God's name is laughed at in our community today as a result of God's people not living up to His standard and not being who He's called us to be. But yet Abraham and even Lot at this moment give us a little bit of an idea of how to deal with strife. They give us an idea of how to deal with decision making as it's coming along. As a matter of fact, if you're in chapter 13, look at verse 7. And there was strife. In other words, we know they were Baptists now, right? They were fighting. There was strife. There was differences. There was strife between the herdsmen of Abraham's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. And at that time, the Canaanites, and here's the backdrop. Somebody's always watching. And I'm not talking about Big Brother here. I'm talking about Big God. The Canaanite and the Perizzite were in the land. In other words, they were watching Abraham and Lot talk, hearing them talk. They were watching their conversations and watching their actions. And at that time, they were in the land, dwelling in the land. Look at verse 8. Now notice Abraham's meekness. And Abram, Uncle Abram, said to nephew Lot, "Let there be no strife, let there be no fighting between us, I pray, between me or you." And then he even goes further, and notice this, he says, "Or between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we are brothers." You didn't hear me. They were brothers. They were on the same team. They were fighting the same battles. So Abraham realizes that people are watching, people are taking note, and people are deciding for Yahweh or against Yahweh based upon their life and how they're living and the decisions that they're making. Life is full of decisions, is it not? Who do I speak to in this room this day, this rainy Sunday morning? You're in the middle of a decision for a job, a career. You're deciding whether you're going to leave this alone or engage in this, and you need help. You need counsel. Look up. Get out on your face. Find the will of God in your life and allow God to help you make a decision. There are decisions that have to be made, and if we make the wrong ones, they could devastate your family for years to come. What we'll say today is, well, you know, I'm going to move out to North Carolina because the job is so good, the money's so good, I just can't turn it down. That may be true, but in the process, did you ever decide where you was going to go to church when you got there, or just figure you'll figure that out once you get there? Because you see, we'll find out in a moment that if you'll ask God what's on His agenda, He'll tell us. And you may find out that the place you're moving to may be on God's agenda for destruction, just like Sodom was. And Lot moves into this thing called Sodom because he never asked God one time what to do, where to go, or what would happen when he got there. We see all of that happening. So what kind of decisions did Lot make? Number one, he made a greedy one. If you would, look at verse 10, chapter 13. Lot lifted up his eyes. He beheld all the plain of Jordan. That's a lot of real estate. All the plain of Jordan. And he noticed that it was well watered. Now let me talk from man to man for a moment. Talk to all the men in here. He never one time looked at the plains of Jordan and said like this, "That'd be a great place to raise my children." No, he said, "That'd be a great place to raise my cattle." He never one time thought about his family. He never one time thought about his children. He never one time thought about his children's children being born and being cultivated in that environment. All he saw was it was a good business decision that caused him a lot of greed. But yet it would cause him a lot of pain in the form of his wife and his kids a little later on. So he makes a greedy decision. His eyes became the barometer of his soul. What he saw dictated what his hands touched. What he saw dictated where he would go. Paul says it this way in Colossians chapter 3, verse 2. Set not your affections on things below, but make sure we set our affections on things that are above. In other words, make sure we're looking toward heaven. It's dangerous, isn't it, when we let the money standard be the how we dictate our decisions and all that we do. Yet people do it every day. Look at verse 13. And notice this adjective before the word sinners that describes how wicked it was. Now the men of Sodom were wicked. You caught that, right? They were not just sinners. The Bible says this sin that they were participating in were wicked sinners against the Lord. Notice that. Against who? God. Is it any wonder David did not say that when he prayed in Psalm 51 in his prayer of repentance? It is against God and God only that I've sinned. Yeah, other people were involved, but it was God, first of all, that he sinned against. And that's exactly what this verse says right here. The Bible tells us here they were wicked sinners against the Lord. And when it came time for Abraham and Lot to go their separate ways, Lot chose the well-watered valley along the Jordan River. And Abraham chose to go in the other direction as well. So from a material standpoint, this is a wise choice. Because at the same time, Abraham and Lot really has a growing family, growing children's needs. And so therefore, he was wanting to take care of his family. But God looked at Sodom and didn't see at all what Lot saw. God looked at Sodom and saw that it was next on his agenda for destruction. And here's the sad part. And come in really close. Here's the sad part. This is all information that Lot could have had he asked for it. What decision are you making that you've never consoled God for one time? What decision are you making? School, job, career, family? What decision are we in the process of making right now that we are making because it's what we want to make, but we've never asked God one time what's going to happen if we make it, and if we make it, where's it going to be a year from now? Only you can answer that. Only I can answer that for me. So in the room this morning, there's some decisions that need to be made from all of us, and that is, what type of counsel are you receiving in the midst of the decisions we need to make? We only get God's viewpoint when we ask Him for it. God will not make you to become a Christian until you surrendered your life to Him, even though He could. But He loves you enough to leave you in your sin if you want to stay in it. And as a family member, He wants you to console Him as your daddy. As a family member, as a son and daughter of God, He wants you to talk to Him about the decisions that we make. America is the new Sodom. This cloud of calamity hanging over America today is absolutely growing by the day. It's dangerous to make our decisions upon a world that is on God's agenda for destruction. And I promise you, this country, this world as we know it, will be destroyed. Not the way it was the first time, but in the same book of 2 Peter, we're told how it'll be destroyed the next time. And I promise you, it will be. He was made a greedy decision. Secondly, he makes a religious decision. I mean, that's the irony of it all. Look at verse 10 of chapter 13. And Lot lifted his eyes and saw the Jordan Valley was well watered everywhere. Notice these two opposites. Like the Garden of Eden, and like, if you notice it, the land of Egypt. Two exact polar opposites, and he combines them in the direction of Zoar. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot is trying to combine two opposites. The Garden of Eden, the Garden of the Lord, and the land of Egypt. And many Christians today, all across our country, are doing the very same thing. We're saved enough to go to heaven when we die, but not saved enough to ever talk to a neighbor about Jesus. We're saved enough to come to church even on a wet, rainy, horrible day outside, but not enough to get involved in a discipleship group later on this week across the table from another man or another woman to help them in their faith. We got enough religion to look good on a Sunday, which is wonderful. But what about tomorrow on the job? What about tomorrow at school? What about this afternoon in the neighborhood? Will there be any dialogue by me, by you, by anybody else in the room to tell others about the greatest thing you said ever happened to you? Two opposites. We have the land of Egypt and the Garden of Eden. So he made a greedy decision. He makes a religious decision. And yet you can rest assured, it was a dangerous decision. Look at verse 10. We read the words, Sodom. Just let that sink in. You already know what that word means. You already know how we came about that word, sodomy. Sodom. Sodom was a real cesspool of sin. Sexual perversion in the Old Testament. And it was a cesspool of sin, a cesspool of filth and unrighteousness that Lot was now moving his family into. And it all started back in the plains of Jordan when they were dividing it all up, and Uncle Abraham in his meekness lets him go his way and he goes his. And let me fast forward and say this. God will still let you go your own way. There is a way that seems right unto man, but the ways thereof leads to death. God will still let me. God will still let you. He'll let anybody in this room today. And if you're waiting on the message to hurry up and end, it'll end and you'll be on your own. But you'll make your own decisions and live and die by them. And that's what Abraham was trying to teach Lot. And Lot wouldn't learn. So Lot is working. Lot is operating like a lost man. He's thinking like a totally lost man. He's not consoling the father that saved him at all. And his decisions were greedy, religious, and they were dangerous. Thirdly, he declines. We're not surprised by that, are we? When we're on the path that Lot was on the path that maybe somebody in the room is on this morning, there's a decline that takes place. Now, let me tell you what I know is true. And you've probably heard your pastor say a thousand times, but I forget who told me years ago, but I found it to be so true. There are seldom what we call blowouts in the Christian life. But there are a lot of slow, small leaks. Just the other day in my car, I noticed that my tires were low. And that happens, as you know, in cold spells. Then it gets warm, cold, and warm, and the tires fluctuate. And I noticed that one tire was down to about 19 pounds. And the other one's had about 26. Now, it wasn't anything I noticed right off the bat. But slowly but surely, I noticed the car was driving different. I noticed it had a little sway in it here, sway in it there. And all along, it was just my tires being low because I didn't have a blowout. But I had a slow leak that was causing me some trouble until I got it fixed. So whether it's alcohol, pain meds, porn, food, anger, it's just slow, steady burns until the full, massive part of the sin takes a man or a woman over. Lot's just pitching, as we read in the text, pitching his tent towards Sodom just a little bit at a time. Look at verse 12. The slide continues. And I'll be finished in about 7 or 8 minutes. Let me tell you that up front. I realize it's 11:49. But these next 8 minutes or so, I promise you, are why we all came. So please give me just a few minutes of your time. And now notice how this decline traps him. And how this decline that we're going to read about, causes him to have the grief of his lifetime. Look at verse, I said verse 19, but look at verse 12 first. Genesis 13, verse 12. Lot settled. Now I'm reading from the English Standard Version. Lot settled. He's living. He's not visiting, he's living. He settled down in Sodom. Among the cities of the valley, and moved his tent as far as Sodom. Sodom and Gomorrah. Wherever and whenever we read these names in Scripture, our heightened awareness of sin at its grossest point always comes into play. Their particular sin was sexual sin. Specifically, as you well know, homosexual practices were taking place all under Lot's nose. And he even condones it with his daughters and the two angels that visit later on in the chapters. We don't have time to go all there, but that's what he did. But now notice the slide from chapter 13. For the sake of time, turn over to chapter 19. Now I want to show you something here. Chapter 19. These two angels come to Sodom at night. They come in the evening. Again, I'm reading from the English Standard Version. These two angels come to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. Now, I could be wrong, but the most conservative of scholars, pastors, say this, that Lot had become the mayor. Whether he was or not is really irrelevant, that doesn't matter, but it's for sure he's seated in a high position in the town. He's seated at the gate where all the decisions were made. It'd be like going to the courthouse, sitting up on the square today and listening and watching all the men just make decisions and chew the fat, whatever they do. And that's what Lot was doing. Look at it in verse 1 of chapter 19. The two angels came to Sodom in the evening, Lot sitting in the gate. And when Lot saw them, he rose to meet them, bows himself with his face to the earth. Now get the picture. Here's a man that's been declared by God to be righteous. Here's a man that we read about in 2 Peter chapter 2 that was called just Lot, righteous Lot. Here was a man that had heard his uncle preach, that gave his heart to Yahweh, and now all of a sudden, he's living in a city of unspeakable sin. And not only living there, but presiding over the details of this community day in, day out, week in, week out, year in, year out. He's ruling over a city of sin that's unspeakable. I'll say this and move on. If that's not America, then it's not Sunday and my name's not Tim. This is not a political sermon. This is not a Democrat statement. It's not a Republican statement, an independent. It's a Bible statement. We better get some godly men in the White House. And women. We better get some godly people. You say, well, Pastor, ain't nobody worth a flip running. Pick the best thing you can and go with him. But anybody that wants to kill babies all day long, not getting my vote. And anybody that wants to put homosexuality as an okay sin is not getting my vote. It's just not happening. Now, if you don't like the message, just thank God I won't be here next week. Amen? That's how I feel about it. Pastor, I've always wanted to do what I do. I can come in now, make everybody mad, and just leave. Just leave. But am I telling the truth? If I'm telling the truth, say amen. This is where we are. And there are some people in this room that's kin to Mrs. Lot and Mr. Lot. And we need to make some better decisions. Let me say it this way and say what you think about it. Sodom went to hell for lack of a soul winner. And Lot lived in that town. Who's going to hell in your community, on your job, at your school? Who's on their way to hell, and it's on your watch? You can talk about anything and everything. As an Alabama fan, we can be all upset about the new coach and Owen leaving and all that. As an Auburn fan, y'all got a ton of stuff to be ungrateful for. That's all I know. But I just said that for Brother Ronnie's sake, that's all. I'll be crying with him after our new coach gets in power and I see no count. But my point is this. Why is it happening on our watch? Why is it happening on your watch? Why are we allowing it to happen at all? And I land the plane, and I find ground to land it, and to move in an invitation by asking you to look at verse 26. Here's the worst part. You remember I asked you what was the second shortest verse in the Bible, and we read it out of Luke 17? Remember Lot's wife. Chapter 19, verse 26. But Lot's wife behind him looked back. Now let's don't be too hard on her. Let's don't be so hard on her we don't give a little bit of understanding here. She had a lot invested. Albeit for wrong reasons, but she planted her life there. Lots of time had went off. And the Bible says she was told not to look back, but yet her humanness got to her. She looks back, and the Bible says she became a pillar of salt. Now, I think that's ironic Because when you read Jesus' sermon in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, Jesus himself says that we are to be what? Salt and light. We are to be salt. But this is not the salt that he was referring to. She looked back and was crystallized into a pillar, a block of salt, and lost her life because she was grieving over something that she was leaving that she should have never been a part of. Had her husband ever asked God what he was doing? Had her husband ever asked God what was on his agenda for Sodom? What happened to Lot? Look back in 2 Peter. Look back in 2 Peter chapter 2, and let me read verses 6 and 7. What happened to Lot? Verse 6, 2 Peter 2. If by turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, he condemned them to extinction, making them an example. Now follow me. Don't miss that part. Making them our example. We are to learn from the story we just read. Making them an example of what is going to happen to the ungodly, whoever that is. What we just read is an example for all of us to make different decisions. And if he rescued, you ready for it? Righteous Lot, and he did. Vexed greatly, or greatly vexed and distressed by the sensual conduct of the wicked. Again, this proves that no one's exempt from judgment, not even angels. The word vexed is a word that means to be loaded down with distress. It's a word that means to be tormented. It's the same word that John used in Revelation chapter 20 when he talked about the judgment seat. Lot was living literally a hell upon the earth day in and day out because of decisions he had made and not consorted with God. C.T. Studd said this about this verse, and I want to read it. God knew something about Lot's heart, not recorded in the Old Testament, but was revealed to the Apostle Peter by the Holy Spirit. And I quote, when Lot lived in Sodom, now follow me here, this is a very, very good thing to think about. While Lot lived in Sodom, he endured a daily struggle in his heart against the evil that he was witnessing. He was worn down by the filth that he saw every day to the point that he was tormented by it. That's basically the exegesis of the text. That he was being tormented day in and day out by what he was seeing happen to him. Now let me just say it this way. Does it bother any of us in the room today to see the degradation of our nation go to hell a step deeper every day and us live all around it and in it? Or do we just go on just like it's heaven? Is there anything in us that's vexed? Is there anything in us that's tormented day by day because we just grieve at seeing how wicked the nation has become? What about Lot? She turns into a pillar of salt. In my spiritual imagination, I wonder, you think old Lot ever come out of that cave and walked over to that block and pillar of salt? Do you think Lot ever walked out and he said, sweetheart, I had no idea that living in Sodom and raising our children around all these cattle and all these decisions that we made, I had no idea that it would happen to you this way and you would turn out this way. So I had no idea that our girls would be exposed to sodomy and our girls would be exposed to homosexuality and lesbianism. I had no idea that this would happen just because we moved into Sodom. Do you ever think there was a time that Abraham just saw Lot went over and grabbed that pillar of salt and wished he could hold it in flesh form again? I wonder how many people in here today would say that your life's anthem and your life's thoughts are like Toby Mac's. I don't want to gain the whole world and lose my own soul. Or in the words of George Beverly Shea, that used to lead the worship for Billy Graham before he passed. And before every crusade ended, George Beverly Shea would sing the wonderful song, "I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be His than have riches untold. I'd rather be led by His nail-scarred hand. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land." Every head bowed, every eye closed. Your pastor, Brother Kip, and others will find their way to the altar. And I don't know who the message is for today, but I can tell you this, it was for me. These are things I have to constantly think about. And I don't know about you, but maybe there's a dad in the room today that would say, it's time that I stopped leaning towards Sodom. It's time I stopped pitching my tent towards Sodom. It's time I asked the Lord about the decisions of the new job and the new environment. It's just time that I started looking up and stopped looking down. Maybe I speak to a family that's made some poor decisions and your children are struggling and hurting through it. Maybe a prodigal is left and that prodigal needs to come home. I don't pretend to know all the reasons. I don't pretend to know any of that. But I do not pretend, but I do tell you, I know today the solution. And the solution for me and the solution for you is to trust Jesus. If you've been born again and you're walking at a guilty distance for Him, today's your day to come home. If you've never been saved, never been born again, today's your day to come home. It's the same day regardless. So in just a moment, we're going to stand. And I promise you, I will not linger long. We'll sing one, no more than two verses, or have a couple played. Your pastor and other staff members are here. And maybe you don't need any of them. Maybe you just need to turn the seat that you're seated in into your altar, or come and kneel here. It's up to you. But if God has spoken to your heart, if the Holy Spirit has nudged you, whether to be saved or as a saved man or woman, to make some different decisions, it's my prayer that you'll do that today. Father, I have preached the message that I believe that first part of the week for sure you solidified in my heart. As I prayed and asked you what to do, I felt comfortable in this area. Didn't know exactly why, but that was irrelevant. I thank you for my opportunity to be here. I love Brother Ronnie and Miss Judy. I love this church. I love what they've accomplished. And Lord, you're not finished with any of us. And what you've started, you will complete to the day of Christ Jesus. So these next few moments are yours, just like all of them. So please, I ask you with the power of the Holy Spirit, the conviction of the Holy Spirit in my voice, I ask you to save and change the path that someone's walking on today. I ask it all in Jesus' name. Stand with me if you would. Your pastor, Brother Kip, and others are here. And the invitation is just for you while we wait, heads bowed. You know the value of prayer. I'm asking you to pray. But before we even go any further, while every head's bowed, let me ask this question. While no one's looking, just your pastor, myself, maybe. Here's the question. Did the Holy Spirit nudge you today? Did the Holy Spirit warn you today that it's time to make a change? Did the Holy Spirit nudge you in your spirit today to say, that word is for you? If He did, then I ask you, ma'am, I ask you, sir, I ask you to respond to the grace that you've been given in Jesus' name while we wait. While we wait. Your pastor's here. Brother Kip's here. Other gentlemen's here as well. There's women in the room that'll help women while we wait. We can learn a lot from Lot. We sure can. Bless you, ma'am. So I'll ask one final question before I turn it back over to your pastor. while no one's looking. By the lifting of your hand, would you say, Pastor Tim, Brother Ronnie, Brother Kip, I'm in the process of needing to make and making decisions that I need God's intervention in. Would you pray for me? Would you just raise your hand or make eye contact? Hands are everywhere. Which means the Lord brought us here today to tell us He wants us to inquire. He wants us to ask. And so I ask you today to continue to pray and let me pray. Father, thank you for the honesty in the room. Thank you for the multiple hands and faces that were lifted, which means that you are at work here, and that surprises none of us. So thank you for your word. Thank you for the opportunity that you've given me to be here. I'm grateful, and I look forward to hearing this pastor tell me in days and weeks ahead that you did a great work in this room this morning. And I will thank you and praise you for it in Jesus' name.
Amen. Hey, would y'all do me, you be seated. We're fixing to go. Would y'all thank God for Tim and this word today? Because I mean to tell you, Tim, that man, he spoke to our hearts. And so after the first service, there were several people come to me and said, hey, I'm in a difficult place. James chapter 1 verse 5 says, he that lacketh wisdom, that's not intelligence. He that knows the need in the mind of God, ask God, and He'll give liberally to those who ask. Let's do that. Hey, I want to ask you again to do something for me. 15 minutes ago, I checked my phone while Tim was preaching. Many of you know that my pastor, Ron Aronson, is 83 years old. He lives in Houston, Texas. 15 minutes ago at 83, he walked down the aisle and got married. Well, y'all, if he's listening, Brother Pastor, you know, he's a Messianic rabbi. You can do better than that. Come on, Brother Ron, we love you, and we pray the Lord would bless you. I jokingly asked last week, was he going to have any more children? I just thought I'd ask, and it was about like that when I asked him the question. So, hey, thank Brother Tim for being here. Hey, please go by outside. Let me tell you why Tim is here. I want you guys to know that God's moving around the world. And number one, I want you to hear some great preaching. And by the way, you've probably heard about as good as you're going to hear today. But listen, God's hand is moving around the world. And I want you to see some of these men that God's using greatly to influence and impact lives. And Tim is one of those guys. And so I want you to hear him. Please go by. If you have questions about ICR, something maybe you want to be involved in prayerfully and financially, I would encourage you. I went to Argentina with him one time, came back, was so impressed our church invested $10,000 at that time. So just feel led to have him come, share this ministry with you, and see what God would have us to do, okay? So please pray about that. Please go by there and do that again. It's been good to be in the house, and all the church said, if you're our guest, I forgot to do that. If you're our guest, would y'all say thank you to any guest who may be in the house today? Thank you for being here. Pastor Kip, you come and pray. I'll be right outside the door. If you want to speak to me privately, I'd love to see you right outside the door.
Thank you, Pastor Tim. Wonderful word. Glad to have you here. And come back anytime, brother. I'm sure Ronnie would have you back anytime. Let's pray. Father God, we're thankful for each one here. Thankful for this wonderful word we've heard today. Let us be like Abraham, not like Lot. Let us look away from sin. Let us move towards you. Help us every day, Father, to do that. And help us make the right choices. I pray you bless each one in the sound of my voice. Help them where they have needs and encourage them today. And let them remember Jesus loves them very, very much. And if they need anything, we do too. Let us know. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said? Amen. God bless you. Have a good week.